In this short Abaqus tutorial, we're going to walk through the process of creating a finite element analysis model for the table shown here. We're going to do this in a couple of stages. I'll focus initially on the table top, showing you the basics of using Abaqus to do a single part model. Then we'll add in the reinforcement bar shown on the back of the table and do a second analysis in a second tutorial. And then finally, we'll add in the frame and do a third analysis. This is a typical way to run FEA to break it into smaller pieces and build up your model over time. To start Abaqus, you want to double click on the Abaqus CAE icon. That will open up the graphical user interface for Abaqus called Abaqus CAE. When Abaqus CAE opens, you'll see you've got this start session window that pops up. Normally, you're going to build a new model database with the standard explicit model. There are some other options here. If you've already got a database, which is the main Abaqus file, then you'll open the database here. Or if you're just getting started with Abaqus, I recommend use Start Tutorial. For our case, let's do with standard explicit model. So that takes us into the main Abaqus screen. One of the first things I recommend doing is creating your file. So save your model database. Even though there's nothing here, let's go ahead and get this defined. So I'm going to call this tabletop.cae. Okay, so first of all, let's take a quick look at the Abaqus screen that you see in front of you. It's got several components. First off, you've got a menu bar across the top, standard Windows fare. Each one of these menus has a lot of options underneath, and most of the commands in Abaqus can be found on this menu bar. But they can also be found in other places. For example, you've got toolbars. Toolbars are just below the menu bar. You can move some toolbars around, as I'm demonstrating here, to make things a little bit more compact. The next bar down is what we call the context bar. This identifies what you're looking at in the screen. In this case, what location in the software you're in, that's the module. If I click on that, we can see there are several different modules. And when you're building a model, you usually go one by one through each of these. A few of them you can skip depending on the model, but it's good to always think that this is your process of stepping through and building a finite element model. Next, there is the model that you're looking at. So when you first start Abaqus, you are in model one. It's the model that's created automatically. You can see that here. Over on this left side of the screen, you will also see the model tree. If I minimize model one, you can see there's a little bit more information here, but you can also tell I could have more than one model open at a time. So for instance, if you're working on a lab assignment and you're asked to or perform several different analyses, you could do those in different files, or you could do them as different models within a single file. It's up to you. The last thing over here in this context bar is the part. The moment we have no parts, but if we did, you'd be able to choose which part you were looking at a given time right here. The next area to look at is the toolbox area that's to the left of the viewport. The toolbox area here is specific to the module that you're in. So right now I'm in the part module. If I switch to the property module, we can see all these little icons change. A couple other things to note here. If I hover over one icon, a little help window pops up, tells me what it is, what that icon will do. Second thing to note is there's a small caret you can see, or a black triangle in the lower right of some of these icons. If I click on that icon and hold with the left mouse button, I can see hidden options. So I can change what this button basically does by changing the option. So we talked already about the large blue area being the viewport. Down at the bottom of the viewport, we have something called the prompt area. If Abaqus needs to ask you to do something, it will put some text right at the bottom of the blue area of the viewport. This white box down at the bottom of the screen here is the message area. As Abaqus does work, it will print information into this box, so it'll let you know what's going on. Okay, that's a quick overview of what the interface looks like. Let's go back to the part module and start building our tabletop part. Generally speaking, in this toolbox area, you're going to start with the upper left icon. In this case, creating a part. That makes sense. Now, a part is the geometry in Abaqus. So when I define my part, I can give it a name. I'm going to name this tabletop. And then I can choose the modeling space that I'm going to perform my analysis in. So in this case, I'm going to have a part that represents the top of a table. So it is a two-dimensional surface, but I'm going to apply some loads to it. And as you might expect from a table, one of the loads I want to apply is going to be perpendicular to that surface. In order to be able to apply a load perpendicular to a two-dimensional surface, I have to be in a three-dimensional modeling space. So I'm going to leave that 3D clicked here. Then we get to choose what type of part. Generally speaking, you're going to use deformable parts because you want to see what happens when you apply loads. The base feature is what the geometry is that you're going to use to represent this part. Now, for the top of a table, I have two options for geometry. I can represent it as a solid part, in which case I'm actually going to draw the thickness of the part. I could also choose a shell, which a shell represents a surface, but that surface we can assign a thickness to in order to do analysis. And so this can represent the top of the table equally well as the solid. The other two down here, wire and point. A wire you can define as any sort of beam. A beam or a truss would be a wire. So we'll see that when we do the frame. A wire will be appropriate for that. And then a point, particularly if you're doing dynamic analysis and you want to have points that have mass properties associated with them, you would use the point to create a part. But for our purposes for the tabletop, we're going to use shell, and I'm going to define it in a planar view. So I'm going to be looking down on the top and I'm going to sketch out the dimensions. Approximate size is in whatever units you're going to be drawing in. It's roughly the size of the grid that's going to appear for you. I usually ignore this unless I know I have a significantly larger or smaller part than normal. So I click continue, and this takes me into the viewport module. This is where I get to draw the part. So again, I want to have a trapezoid, so I'm going to choose to draw lines. This is basically a simple CAD package. So I'm going to just sort of pick some points that are roughly in the shape that I want, not worrying about the exact dimensions just yet. When I complete a closed object, this command stops. Note it's waiting for me to start another command. Here's this prompt line I mentioned earlier. So it's waiting for me to pick a new starting point for a new line. I can click the red X there to cancel, or I can choose another option up here and it will override. So I'll cancel first. I've got the basic shape. Now I need to make sure it's the right size. So I'm going to start adding some dimensions. And I'm going to want to define my two angled sides to be 24 inches. The short side here is also 24 inches. And then I need the last side is going to be this bottom one here, and that's going to be 48 inches. Okay, so now we have our part defined. So now remember, the prompt down here is saying select the entity to dimension because it's still in this dimension command. I don't want to worry about that. I'm just going to cancel that procedure. But now it has another prompt, sketch the section for the planar shell. This means it's still waiting for me to say that this is the shape of the part. So if I cancel this, I have canceled the entire operation and I have to start over from scratch. So don't do that. Click done, and it now saves that part. So now I have a part. We move on to the next module, property. So three steps in this module. First off, we'll do the material. This is wood. And Abaqus has a lot of different options for materials. If I click on any of these, we see that there are actually lists of different material types that you can input underneath them. I can use an elastic tabletop. So I'm going to choose mechanical, elasticity, and elastic. And now you see the material behavior shows up here. I have elastic. I can have multiple material behaviors. For right now, this is the only one we need. So for the wood, the properties are going to be 0.58 times 10 to the 6 psi. Again, I'm not putting the units in, but I entered the dimensions in inches, and I'm entering the properties in pounds per square inch. So as long as I apply the loads in pounds, everything will be consistent. Again, it's consistency that matters. Young's modulus for the wood is about 0.25. Okay, there are other options here. We don't need them for right now. So I've now got a material. Next, I need to define a section. So what type of section do you want? Well, I'm going to give it a name. Tabletop is my section. And it is a shell. It's not going to stop me from defining a solid section, but I won't be able to associate that solid section with the planar surface that I just created. So I'm going to choose shell. Homogeneous is the most typical one, so it's up at the top and pre-selected for you. I continue, and then I see the shell is 1/2 inch thick, so 0.5, again, keeping the units the same, inches. The material, it pre-selected the wood material because it's the only one I had. If there were multiple materials, you could choose from a list here. All right, so now we have a section, we have a material, we now need to associate that section with the geometry. Looking down at the prompt here, select the regions to be assigned a section, and I'm going to select that region and say done. Now, what section do you want to apply? Again, there's only one section, so it pre-filled in here, so I'm going to keep that. Okay, property, on to assembly, the next module down. I only have one part, but I still have to put it in the assembly. Think of the assembly as the location where the analysis happens. So, create instance, funny wording here, but what I'm doing is creating a copy of my part. So I created a part, and I'm adding a copy of it into the analysis area. Again, there's only one part, so it auto-added it. You now get to choose what type of add is it. I'm going to choose independent because it makes a little bit more sense later on during the process. Okay, that's all I need to do in assembly. Step, again, kind of funny wording here. Step is the analysis process that you want to undertake. Always going to this upper left option here, create a step. So I'm just going to leave it as step one. Static general is the most common one, and that's in fact what we want here. We're going to apply a static load. So continue. All of this can remain for default for right now, and we've now created that step. Move on to interaction. Interaction is where if I have multiple parts, I define how they interact with each other. I don't have multiple parts, so I can skip this one now. Load. So here's where we apply the loads or forces that are applied to the part. And it's also where we say which parts of it cannot move. So I'm going to start with the parts that cannot move, because conceptually that makes more sense to me. I'm going to fix it first and then add the forces. So locations that can't move are called boundary conditions. So I'm going to create a boundary condition. I always switch to displacement rotation so I can say exactly what directions things can move. And I'm going to continue. So now in the part that we looked at, in the initial model for the table, there is a support that runs over the three smaller sides of this table. So I want to represent that support initially by simply creating a condition that says that those edges can't move downward. So the regions that I want to select are the three, and I have to hold down shift as I move around. Three around the sides. I say done. Now what do I want them to do? I don't want them to move out of plane. So I look at my little graphic here, X, Y, Z is the out of plane direction. Here U's are displacements. 1, 2, and 3 are X, Y, and Z. UR's are rotations about an axis. So all I want for those three edges is that they can't move in the Z direction. And I say okay. Also, while I'm in load, I actually need to apply my load. So I want to create a load. I'm going to do a load in the middle of this edge, and I'm going to apply a force of about 500 pounds right on that edge just to see what will happen. It's a concentrated force. I continue, select the point, and I can't select the point because there's no point there. Okay, so we need to cancel out of this. That was a bit of a trick. We need to do a partition. In order to select a point for a load to be applied, you must have a point present in the geometry. So what I can do, again, see this little black triangle there, click and hold on that. The red one says I can partition an edge by selecting a midpoint. And that's what I want. I want the load at the midpoint. So I select that option, and it tells me to select an edge to partition. So I grab that lower edge. And then select a point on the edge. I want that midpoint. And now it's defined the partition. I need to click here to create it, which I do. Now you see I've got a point at that location. Notice if I hover on this edge now as well, we have two different edges. So the partition has broken the edge into two parts. Okay, so now I can go back and create my point load. Again, I'm going to call that edge point load, continue, and I can select the point that I want it to be acting at. And now I can have, this is concentrated force in the X direction, Y, and Z direction. I want to have this force acting in the Z direction, 500 pounds. All right. Okay. Mesh. You can't run an analysis without meshing your part. So the first thing to mesh your part is to seed the instance. That's say how large the elements should be. It comes up with a default size that gives you a reasonable mesh. I'm going to go with that initially. And you can see it's now marked where the nodes might be on the outside when you apply that condition. And I'm going to then mesh the part instance. Is it okay? Yes. And there's a mesh. That looks pretty reasonable. Okay. Optimization is if I want to change the geometry or change the mesh as the analysis proceeds. So we're not going to do that now. Job. Create a new job using the model that I already have. Stick with the defaults. Now I want to submit my job. Job manager. Submit. I have already run a job that was called job one, so it's warning me about that. And now it's submitted. While things are submitted, I recommend clicking on the monitor button. The monitor button allows you to see what's happening as the analysis is proceeding. And that one ran pretty fast. You can scroll through the comments here, but it's just basically saying it submits, it runs, and then we're done. So I can dismiss that and go to results. Results, I look at the part, which is it's an interesting perspective. I apply the load and we see that it deflected as we might have expected it to deflect. All right, so that is my deflection, and that's kind of what I would expect with a plate like this applying a point load. About the magnitude, well, it's really hard to read that, isn't it? So since it's a little hard to see, we're going to change the annotation options. So go up to viewport, do viewport annotation options. What I want to do is change the fonts for the legend. That's going to make this upper left legend look reasonable. And then the title block, which is down here, and then the state block, which is there. I might have those two reversed. I'm going to set them all to the same font. Right now they're at 8. I'm going to change it to 14. So 14 looks nice. I'm going to then say OK and do that for the title block as well. Set the font to, maybe we'll just do 12 for the title block. And then the state block, we'll do 12 as well. Okay, so now we can see the von Mises stress, that's the default, S comma Mises is von Mises stress. So we're getting some peak high stresses in those corners, which seems odd to me, which tells me I probably need to be a little bit more accurate. My boundary conditions are producing something strange there. So I'm going to revisit this in a later analysis. Let's look at the total deflection. Two more things I want to show you here. These up here in the toolbar, you can see primary S and Mises. If you click on the menu next to S, you can see these are all of the different standard outputs that I got. So if we choose U, remember U is displacement, this shows me the maximum displacement. So under a 500 pound load, I got almost 10 inches of displacement. There's another way to do this displacement. Get rid of the annotation box. Up here, there's a little I inside a circle. That's my query command. If I select that and then come down to the second box, probe values. Probe values allows me to look at specific information. So right now, it's gonna, as I hover around, it will give me information about the magnitude of the deflection. But right now it's looking at elements. You can see the boxes are highlighted. So it's gonna give me the center of the element. I'm gonna switch it over to nodes because I wanna look at a specific point. And now if I hover over, I get the magnitude of the deflection at that point. What if I don't want magnitude? Well, come on up here, change it to a particular direction. For instance, the Z direction. So the Z direction displacement is negative 9.924 on this. Okay, so that's a quick overview of how to use Abaqus to do a simple analysis. We'll come back in a later one and add another part and see how that affects our results.